Coming up next on Jonathan Bird's Blue World, Jonathan goes to inner space at NASA's Neutral Buoyancy Lab, where astronauts are trained.
Hi, I'm Jonathan Bird, and welcome to my world.
Takes me on adventures all over the planet. Today's adventure takes me to the Johnson Space Center at NASA in Houston, Texas.
And I'm standing on the International Space Station!
Well, not exactly. I'm standing on an underwater full-size replica of the International Space Station in a gigantic indoor swimming pool. Here, they train astronauts to work in zero gravity by simulating these conditions underwater. Outside, it just looks like a huge warehouse, but inside is the Neutral Buoyancy Laboratory, the NBL. I arrive early in the morning and meet Daniel Sade, the facility manager, who has arranged our visit. Hey, Dan.
Good morning, Jonathan. Welcome to the NBL.
Thank you. I can't wait to see this place.
Let's come on in and get you all set up.
We drag all our gear inside and get our first glimpse of the NBL. This thing is huge, a swimming pool nearly the size of a football field. As we arrive, the morning mission briefing is just starting. The entire team, from astronauts to support divers to technicians, are all given a thorough run-through on the training exercises for the day. And cameraman Tim and I are part of this meeting, because they're going to let us dive in the NBL today with the astronauts. Our morning starts with a quick checkup. All divers in the NBL must pass a rigorous physical and a checkup before the dive. Cameraman Tim and I are no exception. We pass our checkup, and next we meet up with Sarah Williams, the dive training officer who gives us a dive safety briefing.
The pool deck itself is also a functioning, working pool deck.
What to do and what not to do in the NBL.
So all divers need to comply with the direction of the dive supervisor. As I said, they are the supervisor on deck. Please give them a heads up when you're getting ready to get in the water so they know that they have someone to account for.
Just as we finish our briefing, the team is gathering on the deck to begin preparations for putting the astronauts in the water. Getting into a spacesuit is no easy feat. In fact, it might be easier in the zero gravity of orbit. But here on land, it takes assistance. The astronauts wear liquid-cooled underwear to keep them from overheating. That's what these tubes are for. The torso of the suit is clamped to a cage because it's too heavy to lift. Because this spacesuit is specially modified for underwater use and has a lot of lead weight in it. Climbing into the torso is a little tricky. It takes nearly an hour to suit up. The last thing to go on is the helmet. Underwater, a high oxygen blend of air will be fed to the astronauts through their umbilicals. Meanwhile, the safety divers are in the water getting ready. They wear double scuba tanks so they have enough air to stay down as long as necessary to complete the mission. Tim and I are getting ready too. I can't wait to see this enormous underwater facility. I descend into the clearest water I've ever seen, and it looks like an underwater movie set. The pool is a staggering 40 feet deep, and everywhere I look are full-size replica sections of the International Space Station. I take a few minutes to explore the pool. I can see from one end to the other very clearly, meaning that the underwater visibility is over 200 feet. I could spend a few hours just swimming around down here. It's like a playground for divers with all sorts of great structures to swim through. For the astronauts, now the moment of truth. A crane lifts them into the pool, wearing 300 pounds of spacesuit apiece. Underwater, the safety divers meet them and carefully remove them from the platform. Each astronaut is carefully weighted to be precisely neutrally buoyant. Hey, they don't call it the Neutral Buoyancy Lab for nothing. Once weighted properly, the astronauts hover in the water as if floating in the weightlessness of space. Since fins don't work in space, the astronauts don't get to wear them here. They must be moved from task to task by the divers. The divers are also responsible for keeping a careful eye on everything happening. Each astronaut has four divers assigned to him or her. Two are safety divers. Another has a camera with a cable going to the control room. And there are more cameras mounted all over the inside of the pool, too. In the test director room overlooking the pool, 21 monitors keep the staff informed of everything that happens below. They oversee the safety of the operation. If anything were to go wrong, the divers can get the astronaut to the surface in only seconds. In the test conductor room, another team is conducting the training run. The test conductor and team speak directly to the astronauts through the communications gear in their helmets. But powerful underwater speakers allow the divers to hear everything that's being said, even if they can't talk back.
Go ahead and swim EV1 over to Z1 to check out EV2's APFR ingressing.
The point of all this effort is to provide a learning environment for astronauts where they can practice tasks over and over in simulated zero gravity before they're required to do it by themselves in space. Tasks that are easy on land become much harder in zero gravity. And harder still while wearing a spacesuit that has to be able to protect an astronaut from the vacuum of space. A spacesuit is designed to have more pressure on the inside than on the outside, since it's effectively inflated like a balloon in space. Here in the NBL, that pressure is backwards. Water is definitely not a vacuum. In order to keep the water pressure from squishing the astronauts as they go deeper, the suits are inflated to a pressure just a few psi higher than the surrounding water. When an astronaut goes deeper into the pool, the water pressure pushes in on the suit and tries to compress it, so the suit is given more internal pressure to keep it inflated correctly. As the astronaut ascends towards the surface, the air inside the suit expands and tries to overinflate the suit, so some of the air is released. In this way, the suit always stays inflated just as it would be in space. After a couple hours of training, the divers move one of the astronauts over to the platform and remove her glove. This training exercise simulates a suit failure, and it's one of the things that astronauts practice underwater. The continuous flow of bubbles from the sleeve shows the regulator in the suit attempting to maintain positive pressure. Soon, the astronaut is lifted from the water after a successful training mission. Tim and I head back to the surface, too. Later, I have the opportunity to meet Ron Garin, a real astronaut. He has spent nearly half a year in space and more than 27 hours spacewalking. So you know what I had to ask him.
You gotta tell me what it's like to be in space.
What's it like to be in space? Well, it's a lot like being in the pool here. The only difference is when you turn upside down in the pool, you feel upside down. When you turn upside down in space, there is no upside down, so you don't feel that, have that sensation of blood rushing to your head, and you can't beat the view.
Yeah, I guess that's true, huh? What did you do here that helped you as an astronaut?
Well, what we do here is we train for our space walks. There's two ways to look at it. One is that when we were flying the shuttle, we had very, very specific, very choreographed spacewalks. And so for every hour that we spent outside in the vacuum of space, we spent about 7 hours underwater, making sure that we knew exactly how things were going to be. There's a full-scale mock-up, as you guys saw, there's a full-scale mock-up of the space station down there. So just to know how to get around, to know the lay of the land, if you will, know how the equipment works. But nowadays, since we don't have the space shuttles, what we're really training for is if something breaks. If we have a piece of equipment that breaks, then we have to go out and sometimes in a fairly expeditious manner to fix the equipment. And we never know what's going to break beforehand, so we have to kind of train a skill set, you know, to learn the basic skills on how to fix anything that can go wrong outside.
I spend an hour chatting with Ron about being an astronaut and training underwater in the Neutral Buoyancy Lab. I explain that I'm a perfect choice to join the space program. I mean, after all, I'm already good at working in zero gravity. But I don't think he was convinced. So, instead of joining the space program, the Blue World team ended our exciting day by getting our picture taken with Ron. Sometimes my adventures in the Blue World take me to fascinating places I'll never forget.